And service providers, OEMs, and industry vendors are finding business opportunities in offering IoT solutions by enterprise customers on this segment of TI Now. From TIA's Connectivity Jam right here in Dallas, Texas, are Richard Finn. He's lead product marketing manager at AT&T. Next to him is Christoph Anauen. He's vice president of strategic partnership and solution portfolio IoT at SAP. We also have Sumit Mittal. He's business development at Nest Labs. Next to him is Jason Hallstrom. He's director, Institute for Sensing and Embedded Network Systems Engineering at Florida Atlantic University. And at the end, and last but not least, is Steve Brummer. He's partner at 151 Advisors. And gentlemen, welcome to the panel.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here. I want to go right to Sumit and Christoph really quickly about maybe the variance in benefit of IoT between consumer and enterprise, or consumer and industrial, and on a number of levels, maybe on the technology level, but really on the monetization level as well. And Sumit, I'll start with you.
Sure. So, certainly it's an interesting question, and a question that many companies are trying to address. So from a consumer standpoint, when consumer is looking for a solution for an IoT, all they're looking for is to address a pain point that they have. They bought a new home, so they need a camera. They have a baby, so they need a camera to look after that baby, or they want to have more comfort and energy savings, so they buy a thermostat and things like that. So they are looking for that plug and play, easy to get done kind of an offering to help solve a pain point that they have, which is a very important perspective, and you're trying to solve a sort of a consumer problem here, which I think is opposite of, not really opposite, but different than, let's say, on the enterprise side, which is looking more for a custom-built solution built on top of a given base.
I agree, Sumit. I mean, this is really the way as I see the differences. The kind of problems we're trying to address in the enterprise space are different in the consumer space. The business case model may be very different as well. On the monetization side, you mentioned that point. I think the challenges are as well very different. On the consumer side, there's a lot of good ideas things that can be done from a technology point of view, but the question sometimes is, well, is there money to be made, right? Certainly the same questions apply on the enterprise, the business side as well. On the enterprise and business side, we try to focus more on what I call operational efficiency type of problems that so many of our customers deal with. That's where a lot of the savings come from. Some of the customers in the enterprise space try to create new business models and the way they go to market. But I think the challenges are really different, and we need a different approach altogether.
Yeah. Do you think that consumers have in mind a theme that binds IoT? Does IoT exist for the consumer, or are consumers thinking about individual pain points, and
absolutely
the tools
right.
I use for my kid are totally different than the tools that I use
fridge
or whatever?
Moss doesn't care about IoT. For them, IoT means nothing. For them,
right,
a camera
right.
means something to look at. A thermostat means
right.
something to control their heat and cold with. A smoke alarm means something that will protect them, even though they never change the sensors. But you're absolutely right. For mass audience, for consumers, IoT has no meaning. But I bet on the enterprise side, it has a huge
absolutely
value,
right.
because you can actually showcase an ROI on what savings you can do. I mean, you gave an example earlier about this, I think in about a train operator
right.
that saved 8 to 10% off a $1 billion cost, which I think is a great business case in itself.
Mm. Well, it's interesting
absolutely.
To use as a jumping off point for understanding IoT, right? Because one thing I like to do when I start talking about IoT, and I talk to people who are unfamiliar with the term, is I actually start with a Nest. And I say, people are familiar with that as a thing, or the Ring
doorbell,
right? And things like that. Something that they see in their everyday experience, okay? Then I jump off that to what's behind that, right? What are the building blocks that enables that to be? And that comes down to our enterprise platforms like with AT&T and SAP have.
And
it's interesting when you talk about monetization, because that's we at 151, that's our tagline, monetizing the connected world. And it's so difficult to sit there and try and bring a client into the consumer side of IoT, because how do you get on the shelf at Best Buy? How do you get on the shelf in that world?
Tough.
And if you do bring another IP camera to market, you're on page 27, if you're lucky, on Amazon.
Absolutely.
And so it's so difficult to show the value add, the differentiation between your product and everybody else.
Hit it on the head. I was talking earlier to people. I think the IoT for consumer is becoming more like a app store, right?
Well, what about connected home?
I mean, you don't need a connected home. That's what I'm saying. You don't need one box.
Okay.
What you need is you're trying to solve your individual pain point. At some point in your life, when you have a camera, you have a thermostat, you suddenly realize, I probably have some sort of connected home, right? But Moss really is trying to address those individual needs.
What do you think about these kind of hubs that are emerging? So you have the Google Home, and you have Amazon's
new
offering.
HomeKit versus
on those hubs, first of all, you have to differentiate between a hardware hub versus a software hub. So in my opinion, I'm not a big believer, and that's my personal opinion, I'm not a big believer in a physical hardware hub. I think it's outside of the fact that it's a single point of failure, it's just not sustainable, right? It's from a security standpoint, from a deployment standpoint. The typical example is August lock,
right?
They had that hub and it got hacked. Many locks, they got unlocked, right? You can say the same for a router, right? If a router gets hacked.
You would think that's worse.
It's absolutely, but that's at least one place where you can control certain things from a software standpoint. If you have another hub that is talking to one more hub, you're just adding more points of failure.
But doesn't the consumer like to have that one thing that controls the whole home and gets access to all of this?
I don't think so. I don't think so.
Really?
I don't think people need a central station to monitor it. They might need a central OS, right, to help them do it. So HomeKit.
Distributed across.
Right. HomeKit or Nest works with Nest platform. That's, in my opinion, it's somewhat helped connect these things together as a software fabric, right?
Yeah. And it's interesting on our enterprise side, because we're now starting to look at voice activated controls on the enterprise side based off of what we're seeing in the consumer side, which is a lot of people would much rather talk to the hub and get it to do something across the room than to get on their app and start playing around.
Yeah, exactly.
And we're seeing that on the enterprise side too.
You know, though, I want to talk just for a minute about a very important point that you raised a second ago. Or a minute ago, Steve, which is the value discussion, right? I think the value discussion takes place both on the consumer side as well as on the enterprise side. It's just a slightly different proposition. But, you know, think about this. What makes us buy a Nest thermostat, for example, right? We go into maybe a Home Depot or whatever, and we look at all these different thermostats, right? And this thing does something special for us. Mm-hmm. It adds value in our eyes, right? So that makes us spend maybe another $50. And I claim it's the same on the enterprise side, right? These guys, they think as well about, well, if I spend a dollar, what do I get in return?
Yeah.
I mean, it's always that decision. And from that point of view, I don't think the discussion is all that different, whether it's a consumer discussion versus an enterprise discussion. It's always value-driven, almost never. Technology driven.
You also bring another point. You guys mentioned security. Something that's interesting is we have these consumer devices that get hacked, and you have so security is an issue. But you haven't really seen consumers demanding it, though, right? In some ways, they expect it, but they don't necessarily want to pay extra. They're not seeking out things to pay extra. And it's something that we on the enterprise side we care a lot about.
Right.
And we try to enable security, but how do you do that if the consumer is not asking?
Think about our laptops, right? Or think about any other digital device we have ever had as a consumer versus when you're working for an employer, right? You're at home, you don't care, you buy a laptop and then you do whatever you want to do.
Right.
It's open to what you can, you know the ROI for it, right? And you work on it. On the enterprise side, they need to make sure that it's secure, people are not browsing stuff that they should not be, right? And it's not hacked by outside entities. So I think the perspective of these two audience on the enterprise and consumer is different, and you know, you need to prove the ROI, but then the way they look at that ROI is very, very different.
Great.
Do Do you think that that has to do with the level of attacks that the enterprise versus the home might be seeing?
Absolutely. I mean, the DDoS versus you know, the enterprise side.
But if you have a bunch of homeowners who have someone break in and erase all the pictures on their Nix Play frames or on their Aura frames, people are going to freak out. and then they'll pay more.
That's right.
Absolutely right. Absolutely right. And on the enterprise side, I think the impact is broadened, right? So when a hack happens on a train, right, and the whole system goes down, it's going to impact
profound.
The whole city.
Absolutely.
If a hack happens on a camera, it's going to be around 5,000, 100,000, 50,000 houses spread all over the country.
Right.
So not a mass calamity.
So are you predicting the idea that no one's going to be able to get into the millions of Nest thermostats and automatically hack in and raise the temperature to 100 degrees in 10 million homes?
I think every device on this planet Earth is hackable, right, to some extent.
Okay.
If you ask me about Nest, I cannot comment on our sort of, you know, what is going to happen in the future or what has happened in the past. We do pay a lot of attention towards those security parameters and how we manage our sort of the platform, if you want to call that. But ultimately, I think the onus is on the manufacturer of the devices or the makers of the platform to make sure that their system, whether it's their own devices or the ecosystem that they're catering to, it's secure, right?
Yep.
And there will be hacks. There will be hacks across the board, and we will learn from it. We will add value to our platforms as we go, but that's the nature of the business. I mean, that's how software runs.
For that, I think we look at different layers of the security, right? Because you have the device itself, you have the network, and which is multiple layers of the network, right? You have the transport, is there security at that level? Is there security in the transmission of the data, right?
Yeah.
Things like SSL or certificates.
Absolutely.
And then you have the application that's in the cloud, is that secure, right?
Right.
And then you have to have mitigation because, like you said, you may not be 100% secure, so if that device is hacked, now what happens? Now you have ways to limit what that device can do. Do you have ways to limit the amount of data it can send so it's not all of a sudden perpetrating a DDoS attack or, you know, some kind of botnet thing. So that's something that now when we talk about platform on the enterprise side, that's something we can enable the guys like at Nest to be able to embed in their products, is the security at multiple layers and the mitigation.
Yeah, one of the things that we're seeing on the enterprise side right now is we hope to have at 151 a client in the eSIM area and who is putting together a huge network security infrastructure around the eSIM.
Right on the SIM.
Right on the SIM.
Right.
Does that matter? I mean, in your case, it's Wi-Fi mostly enabled, right? Not worrying about a 4G, 5G enabled product offering, but you can look at it from being on a SIM type of environment, whereas us on the enterprise side are looking all day long on the edge and everything else to be able to look at eSIM scenario. Is that important from a technology standpoint?
I think it is. I mean, eSIM, let's say the whole concept allows a new model. Up to now, basically the model that's available is roaming, right?
Right.
So we take a US SIM card and we plug it into a device here in the US, and maybe that truck rolls to Mexico, and in theory we do roaming.
Yeah.
Now with the eSIM model, you can actually flip that a little bit and apply a local profile as the truck enters Mexico.
Right. With
that
local
can have
security
local security, local data treatment, stuff like that, and it can change. It can have an effect on the money side as well, because no longer deal with roaming necessarily. Right, it's a different setup. So I mean, personally, I actually really see that the eSIM concept has a lot of potential.
Absolutely.
And I think, it will enable more and more of these IoT use cases for which there maybe before wasn't really a good business case. Right? So it changes the monetary side in some ways.
Agreed.
I wanted to get to Richard about really the relationship between the communications infrastructure and IoT or IoT deployments. And you can refer to the consumer side of IoT or the industrial side of IoT, but what's the current state of play for communications infrastructure?
Thank you. I was about to ask.
So, communications infrastructure is, we're very much focused on things around enabling devices, right? So something we had talked about before was 5G, and 5G has a lot of interest in the future when it comes to maybe connected car and things like that. However, when it comes to IoT, a lot of the devices are sending very small amounts of data, right? So speed is not an issue. Mm-hmm. Coverage is the issue, right? And that's where, you know, we just launched LTE-M, which is industry standard, and a few other carriers have as well, where you can have things that may have used low power wide area or even Wi-Fi before. Now their infrastructure can be based around cellular, right? Mm. Now that brings in benefits around connectivity in places where you might not have it, where you don't trust the network, or where you don't have a local network, or where you're putting something in a place where you still want to have your direct connection to that device, right? But you don't necessarily, you may have a relationship or there may be a local network that can use the device or that can get to some of the data, but you still want to have the direct connection. So a scenario I like to use is talking about leasing equipment. And with interesting with LTE-M, you can actually put equipment in a facility, in a home or in a plant, and be able to pull that data out and be further away from the cell tower, even be underground in some cases. So that we definitely see that infrastructure, as that expands, you're going to see a lot more use cases for having cellular in smaller and smaller and cheaper devices, right? Because we're also driving the cost down, driving the power requirements down, and things like that. And so now, and then that will bring over back over into the consumer side. You get to a point, and you can imagine a situation where a thermostat might wake up and say, hey, there's no local Wi-Fi. I'm just going to connect direct over cellular, right? And that infrastructure will be in place.
How far off do you think we are from seeing these ultra low power cellular chips making their way down to where
they're
right
affordable.
Where they're affordable and right now where we see a lot of play in terms of the sub gigahertz radios. So at that really resource constrained end of the spectrum, you know, we've got lots of interesting devices that are emerging that you'd love to have cell connectivity in, but right now the power consumption is a limiting factor.
You're saying, again, with LTE-M, and you'll see other, as the standard matures, so one thing that's nice about it for the carrier side is, by and large, it was a firmware upgrade. So there's not a lot of new infrastructure needed to be able to put that out there, right? And we have things like, again, to talk about some of the things we've been doing with our starter kit, has a firmware upgrade to LTE-M to start testing it. And then, but you'll actually start to see modules manufactured for LTE-M in the single digit for a module, right?
And then, $10.
I forget the wattage on the battery, but say you take a use case today that may last, you know, 3 to 5 years on a battery, with LTE-M, they're talking 10 years.
Yeah, 7 to 10.
Right? So, and then maybe you add some energy harvesting on top of that, and it lasts even longer.
So I have a question, Richard, for you. I mean, I think you as an operator, you sit in a very interesting place right now. You know, Christoph here is talking about enterprise. I'm talking about consumer. But I think you have seen both the worlds, right, as an operator. You have an enterprise-grade platform that you are serving to your enterprise customers. Similarly, you have AT&T Digital Life that you are catering to the consumer. Can you share with this panel what AT&T has learned for when you compare these two platforms, how different the segment is, and which one is more successful in your eyes?
Well, it's interesting. So there are different business units within AT&T, so I have more experience with the industrial side.
Okay.
And I see a lot of variety, but a lot of it comes down to us enabling solution, or system integrators rather, and folks like yourself to build applications, to build vertical solutions. We have some that we offer as well around things like fleet and asset tracking. But on the consumer side, we've done more of the actual device itself. Now, some things we do enable, but and of course, Digital Life is our thing. But where we see the bigger uptake for IoT is on the business side, the enterprise side, from what I've seen.
If you want to test that out, go be an educated consumer. And I do that a lot. So I'll go into an AT&T store, go to the back far right-hand corner to go to Digital Life and wait for a sales rep to come talk to me.
Yeah.
I go into Best Buy and sit there and wait for one of those kids in a blue shirt to come sell me on a Nest thermostat, a Philips Hue light, or something else that's on in that aisle that's standing there.
Yeah.
Or go to an Apple store and start to talk to them about HomeKit. Those kids have no idea, like you said before about IoT, They have no idea what it is, and they just trying to figure out there, but their lack of education, their training capabilities is there. And then if you look on the enterprise side, we have a whole separate team of enterprise sales reps right. that are selling industrial IoT.
I mean, you don't expect an enterprise walk into a
that's
store and
that's
do it.
That's exactly
it's
right.
But it's sales people.
That's correct.
And, you know,
I'm pitching. I want to be able to help you sell better.
Yeah. You know, on that one, I just picked up on a little clue. I think actually as an industry, we make a mistake by labeling everything as IoT.
I agree.
Right?
Exactly.
Because at the end of the day, what is the IoT, right? It's like in the 90s, well, I'm that old, I remember that, the internet, right? So ask yourself, who bought the internet? No one, right? What you buy is a service on top, maybe email or, you know, web browsing or whatever. You buy services. And I think as an industry, on the Internet of Things side, we need to start talking more about the value of a specific use case rather than, you know.
Well, I mean, and you start
technology.
To divide that up, right? So how many of, you know, I've been in M2M for almost 20 years.
Yeah.
So I look at industrial as still M2M, whereas consumer is IoT. Because if it wasn't for that company in California that came up with the internet of everything and changed the whole marketing theme of every, we would have had it.
The interesting part is when we talk about Nest, we don't talk about IoT. We don't say it's a connected home.
Absolutely.
Exactly. We actually say it's a smart home. It's a home that takes care of people inside.
That's right.
Once
right?
again, it's this individual application
rather
than this whole thing.
I mean, it's, well,
when it's within the home.
Exactly.
Smart home.
And when people they go into the market, whether Best Buy or AT&T store, and they have a need, right? They want you know, I just bought a home. I need a home security system.
Right.
I have a baby. I have a dog. Right. I need that, you know, the connected dog feeder.
Yeah. Right? You'll never walk into a Lowe's, a Home Depot, a Best Buy, you know, or Micro Center and see the IoT center.
Right.
Exactly. It doesn't exist. It's a smart home.
Yeah.
It's you know, it's something like that. And it's digital life. It doesn't say it's an alarm.
Well, somewhat too. That's just it goes back to that classic product manager problem, right? Are you talking features or benefits? In this case, you're not even talking. You're talking the underlying technology idea, which is the whole thing is about what platforms. But IoT itself is a kind of platform.
Yeah.
And we talked about it in the thing, you know, you need apps pull platforms.
Right.
And it's hard to sell just a straight platform that can do anything, right? You need to see what is a true tangible benefit to me. That's what I'm buying.
Yeah.
Right. No,
I mean, on that point, I would go as far as to say, you know, the value of the platform itself is limited, right? The real value of a platform is to be there as an enabler. For the use cases,
right?
Again, there's value in the platform, don't understand me wrong, but it's limited, right? The real value lies when you can actually take those services and you can create a use case or
enabling
a use case.
These verticals
exactly.
on top of this
right.
horizontal
that's
platform.
That's where the value lies.
It's got to be able to be an interoperability platform.
Absolutely.
I think we're failing within the industry in not being able to get the word out that you can connect thousands and thousands and thousands of things with a properly embedded platform or control mechanisms.
Right.
You know, whether it be in a connected home as more, you know, I mean, what are they saying? They're predicting that 25 IP addresses will be inside a home, you know, within the next 5 years. And, you know, that's a lot to control.
I think
it's only going to happen.
I'm just going with
but I'm also not going with 55 billion devices either.
Right,
so,
right. I have one more question from me, and I apologize going back to you, Richard. I think talking to a carrier and then letting it kind of spark the conversation down the line is a good way to do it. Interoperability between cloud providers. What's an issue around that, and are there issues around competition between these cloud providers?
Yeah, sometimes there's what we call co-opetition, right? Which is this idea of you know, we talked about this briefly earlier, when someone like AT&T and SAP, say, come into a customer and we're competing against each other, and a lot of times the customer tells us, we'd rather you guys work together, right? And we see this with other cloud providers, with you know, Amazon and IBM and Microsoft, more and more we're partnering on solutions and verticals to go in and say, here's something that we've built together, right? This leverages the best of what we all offer. You know, it is interesting, AT&T sits in an interesting spot of being in this network, so we can kind of connect a lot of things. And that puts us in an interesting position as far as being a part of stuff, but at the same time, there's that question of like beyond the connectivity, what's the value, yeah. right? And so then we talk about our network and things like that, but we are in some ways, I think, pushing interoperability. We talked about this in not just the panel, but the breakout session was about standards and how do you start to bridge these gaps. And I think it starts with some of these smaller relationships of trying to say, we need these things to work together. Our customers are asking for these things to work together. And that starts the conversation, that starts the process. And then maybe behind that comes some kind of a standard where it's more than bilateral, there's multiple people that come in. But what do you guys think? Have you seen that as well? Or
yeah, so for me, you know, IoT is a fantastic example where the ecosystem needs to come together. Mm-hmm. I claim there's not a single company out there that can solve all the problems of IoT, right?
Right.
So there should not be one.
No,
well,
exactly.
Well,
there
still
can't be one.
Yeah. I mean, you can't, there's not one. Yeah. You have to string a lot of people together, which is one of my pet peeves within the industry. We're lacking in education. We have to really address the security issue. And integration is the hardest piece that a lot of people are not spending any time doing. And until we figure out, because it's not easy, and because you have multiple clouds, and you might have multiple platforms, and you might have it's
well,
it's
I forgot they mentioned the device side. That's even a bigger component.
That's exactly. Totally agree.
I think this IoT space, when you pose the question around cloud, I think it becomes a bit of a mute question. The reason why it becomes a bit of a mute question is because it's the whole IoT is a combination of software and hardware, and the fabric that connects them together, right?
I think the hard interoperability problem, so we have this question of how do you get the hardware components to talk to one another, how do you get the software systems to interoperate? All of those are challenges that we know if we throw engineers at, that we know how to solve these things. Mm. We've done it before, we can do it again. Mm. What I think we don't know how to do is how do you get semantic interoperability across the data that's coming from these various instruments?
Sure. That's totally agree.
That's a very hard problem that no one seems to have a handle on.
Totally agree, and on that point, you know, I claim we don't need yet another standard or more standards, right? I think what we actually need is, I call it rules of engagement in terms of, you know, how does the sensor world engage with the platform, for example, right?
Right.
How do you exchange data, for example? What format and so forth? And then towards the applications, the same, right? Yeah. What's the rule of engagement there? Maybe through APIs.
And I think one of the big reasons why a player has not identified a solution for that is probably there is no money to be made yet.
That's probably right.
That's probably true.
If five sensors are talking to each other, what is the problem that you're solving?
Right.
Right. Why should they actually, why do I really need to connect?
And who's willing to pay
what
for it?
Exactly.
I think this is where the municipalities come in. So in the municipalities where you have lots of applications, you have lots of sensor feeds coming in, and you have these large scale optimization problems that span water and road and infrastructure and bridges. That's where these kind of things come in. Yeah, I mean, even federally. So you look at the National Weather Service. They maintain a system called Mesonet to bring in non-federal sensing assets. Right. Well, that's a very hard problem to bring in non-federal assets when everybody has a different set of sensing assets, and you want to bring those together into a unified modeling system.
That's a great point.
I think this is where the municipalities can really
play
a big role.
But then again, affordability. Right? Who's going to pay for all that?
Exactly.
Us taxpayers.
Right. Municipality.
So really what you're saying there is you're trying to use the municipality as a market force, as the forcing function on the operators to say, okay, you need a common API contract or something like that for all this data, right?
Absolutely, yes.
But who's the throat to choke in that? Yeah. Are you with your Smart Cities group? Or is AT&T
throat
to choke?
No, you're right. I'm sure Michael Zeter was here last year.
Exactly. Let's just not throw Michael under the bus yet.
Right.
But I think the underlying theme here is municipality is just an example.
The underlying theme here is that
Any entity that needs coverage across different facets,
multimodal sensing,
operational
systems. But that's no different than a utility market.
Municipalities.
I mean, a utility market, transportation market.
Absolutely.
You know, I'm doing everything from tracking the truck to tracking the
produce,
all the way from the vine, all the way through.
So then we define that use case or that vertical, use case under that vertical,
right.
That would help solve the problem, and hence someone will pay for
it. Yeah, I mean, right? That's the one great thing about our technology in the IoT space or the M2M space. We can solve the problems. There's technology available today, a platform,
absolutely,
a product,
absolutely,
a widget, right, a service, an airtime, yeah, a dual mode satellite, yeah, transceiver device. I mean, we have the technology. It's the ROI, the sellability, who's, yeah, going to buy it, how are they going to pay
100%.
For it, is it a leasable thing?
Yep.
So
how do you
are
get everyone to play?
Right, and then I go back to education. Where we within the industry, we have an obligation to educate. And we have to start, like what you're doing at Florida Atlantic, how are you being able to educate all these young people to understand what the concept is, what AI is going to be, data analytics, mm-hmm, big data pieces, what are we going to do with that data, how valuable is it, who owns the data, the privacy security issues. But we have to educate them because, you know, I'm the oldest guy here, but at some particular point, all these young people are going to come into IoT M2M, and they have to understand a lot of this stuff.
All
and
this
we don't
fits
see
together.
And we don't see it. We see them as salespeople,
yep,
but not as the technologists putting the glue together for everything that we're trying
this
to deploy.
This is one of the points that we've been hammering on and hammering on, is that when you look at the next generation of engineers who are going to build these huge IoT applications that everyone has in mind, it can't be that siloed engineer,
right,
who has a specialization in wireless,
right,
or who has a specialization in cloud, or has a specialization in the antenna design.
Well,
it's got to be someone who's got
end-to-end
experience.
Absolutely, we talk about IoT is
pipeline.
That marriage of internet and device. Right, and
domain.
Well, right, and that's exactly right. You have to know fleet, or you have to know asset, you have to know shipping, right? And I actually grew up in the internet development world, right? Started out when I was young and did self-taught programmer, and doing all that software and web development, all that stuff.
Richard, you're still young.
Well, older than you, my friend. And then when I got to IoT, I had to learn all that device stuff, right? And I still have the education process with guys who are programmers, been doing device stuff for 20 years, smarter than I am, very sharp, and I have to go and teach them the internet side, right? And you're right, we used to talk about full stack developers, a guy who could do design and database. Well, now full stack
it's
is
a much bigger.
You got
stack.
A design, yeah, database and device and connectivity.
Oh yeah,
like
you got to know something about
security.
Supply
don't forget
chain.
Security. Yeah. Right. Well, and maybe blockchain too.
And how
that
right.
Yeah.
Right. Right.
Yeah, that's a whole different panel.
Right. Exactly.
We get to talk
right.
about blockchain.
Yeah.
That's
exactly.
for sure.
That's right.
Especially
yeah.
on.
So
AT&T
I have a
side.
Whole list of questions here that are not nearly as interesting as this conversation. So
how did that work
those.
For you, Abe?
What's more important is that TI is hosting a reception right now with Top Shelf Liquor. So we're gonna cut this at this point. I appreciate all of your time, though. Really interesting conversation. I like the back and forth. You guys kind of took it away, and so I didn't really earn my paycheck on this one. Steve, as always, it was good seeing you, and thanks for your time.
No worries.
Jason, good to meet you again, and
thanks
for
here.
Being on the panel.
Thank you.
Sumit, it was good meeting you. Put a face with the phone calls and the emails.
Yeah, thank you.
Earlier, so I appreciate the time, Christoph. Great conversation. Great
Thanks
to have you on.
Me.
Talking about industrial IoT enterprise as well. And it's always great to have a carrier on the panel, Richard. So thanks
My pleasure.
For your time.
Thanks, Abe.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.